This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. And it's our great privilege and joy to greet and welcome all of you this day. And those who are visiting with us, we're glad that you're here. And we pray that your life and our Lord might be enriched. As we prepare our hearts for worship, we come before our Lord in prayer. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Father in heaven, we give you thanks for this glorious day that you have made and this opportunity that you have given each of us and all of us once again to gather together as your people here in your house of prayer and worship. And Lord, while we may come this day with various burdens of heart, we all come with the same need to once again hear your words of life, of forgiveness, and everlasting salvation. And so, Lord, we pray also that the praises we sing and the prayers we offer might bring honor and glory to you. For we pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I invite you to rise for the opening invocation and liturgy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins,
God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We just deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. salvation. Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. To God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is by your grace that we live as your people who offer acceptable service. Grant that we may walk by faith and not by sight in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The first reading on this ninth Sunday after Pentecost is found in the book of Genesis, the 15th chapter, beginning with the first verse. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars, if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
People whom he has chosen as his heritage. From where he sits enthroned, he looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth. those whose hope is in his steadfast love.
Our second reading is from Hebrews at the beginning of the 11th chapter. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gifts. And through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken up, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this, he commended the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants as many as the stars of heaven, and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, and he has prepared for them a city. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah, Lord, to whom shall we go? The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter. Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat and what you are to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be added to you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags and that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This is the gospel of our living Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of Jesus, dear fellow redeemed in Christ, amen. Anxiety, we all have it to one degree or another. Sleepless nights, panic attacks in the middle of the day, racing heartbeat, inability to focus on any one thing for more than a few seconds. Anxiety is symptomatic of our culture. It's no wonder that anti-anxiety meds are among the leading prescription drugs. And it's also why we have an opioid crisis in our country, an abuse of illicit drugs like fentanyl. We are an anxious people, living in a constant state of stress, go, 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 do, 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 and it's eating us up from the inside out. Spiritually speaking, anxiety is the litany we offer to our false gods, the idols that promise health and wealth and happiness and identity and security and meaning for our lives if we just bow down and worship them. But the more that we worship our idols, the more anxiety we have. Anxiety, it's like an all-consuming cancer of the soul. What did Jesus say? He said, "Do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will wear, because life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing." Does anxiety put food on your table? Well, does it? Does it clothe you or your children? Can anxiety lengthen your life? My wife and I were talking about this text last night at dinner, and she was asking me, "So what are you going to be preaching on today?" And we were talking about this text, and I asked her about anxiety and shared with her that it cannot lengthen your life to worry. And she responded by saying, "But I think it might be able to shorten it." That's true. Nothing we do by worrying can add to our life. The only thing that we get by worrying is sleepless nights and anxious days. But you might be thinking, but Pastor, this text... I know it's talking about food and clothing and the like, and, you know, quite honestly, those are not things that I worry about. Well, many people do worry about those things, but let's set that aside for a moment. What are you anxious about? Your health, your kids, your marriage, retirement, a slowing economy, rising inflation, war and chaos perhaps happening in China. January 6th, what? What are you worried about? All of us face anxiety and worry. The question is, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to fret? Or are you going to trust God? But Pastor, but what? Jesus said, "Consider the ravens. If God takes care of them, if he clothes the lilies and the grass, why are you so anxious, O you of little faith?" The question contains the answer and the diagnosis, doesn't it? Little faith. Our anxiety reveals the littleness of our faith and the largeness of our unbelief. When Jesus' disciples were worried because they hadn't brought any bread with them in the boat, Jesus called them little faith ones for not remembering how he miraculously fed the 5,000. When the disciples panicked in a storm and woke Jesus up as he was sleeping, he called them little faith ones. When Peter cried out in a panic as he began to sink while walking on the water, Jesus said, "Why did you doubt, O you of little faith?" We trust God with the big things, right? With forgiveness, with life, with salvation. But all the things that consume our thoughts and cause sleepless nights and anxious days, what do we do with those? Why don't we trust him with those things? Is it not because of our desire to always be in control? Is it not because of our sin and self-centeredness which reveal our little faith? Our inner thoughts betray us, don't they? Our anxieties and the fruit of our desires to be like little gods in the place of God. Idolatry breeds anxiety. Anxiety begins from within. It's a spiritual disorder. It's a storm cloud that hovers around our heads and hearts, an endless spin cycle of thoughts and feelings that seek to define us and who we are. It's the stress of our trying to be God. Anxiety is a stress disorder of the soul, where we find no rest, no inner peace, no quietness, no stillness. All of this calls for repentance, doesn't it? The life of a believer is the life of repentance. Now, unfortunately, when we hear the word repentance, we think in terms of stop. Stop sinning. Stop doing what you're doing and do something else, something better. It sounds good, right? But when you focus on not sinning, stop doing that, what do you tend to do? You tend to sin more. Don't eat that cake. Now, cake in and of itself is not bad. It's a gift from God. But some people should not have it. And if that's you, what do you tend to do? You psych yourself up, right? And you begin to say to yourself, man, don't eat that cake. Don't do it. It's not good for you. It's going to spike your blood sugar. And then what happens? You start focusing more and more on cake, don't you? Well, yes, you do. And then what happens? You become more and more anxious until you give in. Another spin cycle of mind and heart and eventually the will. Well, we do that with things like cake, but we also do it with more serious things in our life as well. Repentance isn't like that. It's not stop, 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 a mantra that you keep saying to yourself over and over again. Repentance in the biblical sense is metanoia. That's the Greek word for repentance. It means a change of mind, a new way of thinking of things in a different way, seeing things in a new light from God's perspective. It's seeing things God's way. Jesus says, I have not come to call the righteous, but I have come to call sinners to repentance. Sinners to what? Sinners to metanoia. Sinners to a change of mind. But here's the thing. This calling to a new change of mind does not originate with us. Now, does it? It originates with Christ. Christ is the one who changes our hearts and transforms our minds through the power of His Spirit. So when Christ says, repent and believe the good news, He is the one who equips you to do the very thing that is required. How awesome is that? Remember last week, the rich fool and the contrast to the rich fool being the person who has the dead, open hands of faith, which do what? Receive. So when Christ says, seek first the kingdom of God, know that it's already near you for you to find. It's not like you have to go on a journey of 1,000 miles and crossing all these terrains in order to find it. No, seek and you will surely find it here in God's Word and in His Supper. That's why you're here. Here the King is at work in this, the divine service, giving you the gifts of the kingdom. And we, the people of God, are like the birds of the air and the lilies of the field, simply receiving God's gifts. The kingdom sought is the kingdom that is found. Here, your day, your week, your life is oriented to its center, to Christ, to His work accomplished on the cross and at the empty tomb. The anxiety, or antidote rather, for anxiety is Jesus, who says, what are the words on our building? Come unto me. Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You want to be less anxious? Then seek the kingdom. Seek the kingdom. Seek the kingdom of God in His Word and in His Supper, yes, first and foremost, but also in prayer. I'd like to exhort you this morning that before you occupy your thoughts with your calendar and your endless to-do list, before the spin cycle of the week starts all over again, to be still in prayer. Knock on that door and He will open it. Ask and you will receive. Pray with words and without words. Pray in the Spirit with just sighs and groanings. Pray with psalms. The psalms are a beautiful place to pray. Pray in the silent stillness. Pray as a child of God resting in your Father's arms, nourished by the body and blood of His dear Son, clothed with the splendid robe of Christ's righteousness. Prayer, my friends, is God's gift to you. It's His antidote for anxiety. You know, I can't tell you how many times in my ministry that I've been with someone who's going through a difficult time. Maybe it's a personal struggle. it's a family issue, maybe it's a health crisis, maybe they are dealing with children who are facing all kinds of difficulties because of decisions that they've made. And I say, you know what, let's just press the pause button and come to the Lord in prayer. Why? Because prayer calms us. It lowers our anxieties, and it even actually lowers our heart rate. Did you know that? And our blood pressure. In prayer, there is a transcendent peace that the world cannot give. A peace that calms our anxieties and stills the raging storm. So sometimes it's good just to be still and know that God is God. And He's there right beside you, walking with you step by step as you're facing whatever it is that you're dealing with. Towards the end of our text, we have these words which form the inspiration, if you will, for our bulletin cover today. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's desire to give you the kingdom. This is a beautiful picture. It's a serene picture, not only provided for us by our bulletin today, but it's a beautiful picture. It was common practice in Judea to attend to flocks. The shepherd was a simple, common man who was called to defend them, to provide for them, to lead them beside the green pastures and the still waters. And in all of these things, that's what Jesus is showing us. He's showing us that He is our good shepherd. And it's His purpose to give you the kingdom. And so, my friends, you really have nothing to fear and nothing to be anxious about. And so we end this message where we began. Don't be anxious, but when you are, pray. We think on these things. To God alone be all the honor, the power, and the glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen. I invite you to rise as we together confess our Christian faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. And the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This morning our prayers will be bid with the words, "Let us pray to the Lord," and the congregation responding, "Lord, have mercy." For faith in the wise and gracious will of God, and power to turn from false belief in our own plans and natural powers, let us pray to the Lord. For your church on earth, that by the seed of Father Abraham, our Lord Jesus Christ, she would be defended against the assaults and temptations of the adversary, and that by your Holy Spirit, your people would live unto righteousness in Christ and shine like stars in the heavens forever and ever. Let us pray to the Lord. For Christian fathers, that they, with faith like Abram, would prize the gift of their children work in their lives for the good of generations yet unseen. Let us pray to the Lord for rulers to be granted wisdom to know how small and fleeting their reigns are, and that they would rule in loving service to those in their charge. Let us pray to the Lord. For those in the midst of tribulation and trials, especially do we pray for this day, Carol and Andrea, Dara and Mary, Christine and Paul. We pray for Vicki Beasley, for the family of Eileen Cook, for God's grace to teach her to him. We pray for McKenna, for Evangeline, for this four-year-old child, and Mother Sonia, both now have cancer. Request God's wisdom for their treatment. Pray for Bryan, for Jason and Becky and Isaiah, Ellie and Elise and Kathleen, Bryan, Kristen and Beth, Nora and Chris and Amanda, Ross, Mary, the incarcerated, Leanne, for Barb and Jean and Marilyn, Bob, Beverly, J. Michael, Sharon, and Jan. We pray for this individual's children. We pray for Gottwick and Titlook and Nyamal. We pray for these children that they might come to faith and know God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we lift up all of these children before you. You love each and every one. You have called them by name. They are yours. Bless them. Be with them. We lift them up before you. Let us pray to the Lord. For your Holy Spirit, that your servants who recline at your table this day would be enlightened by your word as a lamp unto their feet, being dressed in readiness for the coming of the Son of Man, both now and at the end of days, even as he girds himself to serve them with his body and blood. Let us pray to the Lord for comfort for all those who mourn, that you would grant every person who is mourning the loss of a family member or loved one this day, both recently or in the past, that you would continue to grant them your peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, knowing that you will hear the prayers of your people and answer us with your mercy, providing all things needful and beneficial to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead, to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. O Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the very night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. For this is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus, strengthen and keep you in the one true faith in body and in soul to life everlasting. Depart in Christ's joy and peace. Amen. Amen. Thank the Lord and sing His praise. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Thank you. congregation may be seated. Just a few announcements to share with you. All of you should have received a letter here this week about our pictorial directory and our desire to update the directory, as it's been over 6 years from our last directory. So it's very easy. Just go onto the webpage and enter in the username and passcode, and it'll take you to the 3 days that we will be taking photos, and just pick a time that works best for you and your family. Next week, I will not be here. I will be in Northeast Missouri, God willing, to celebrate the 175th anniversary of my home congregation, Zion Lutheran Church in Palmyra. So 175 years, that's a long time. It's actually as long as our synod is old. And so I believe C.F.W. Walther, our first synodical president, I know he preached in my home congregation, but if I'm remembering the history correctly, it was at the dedication of the church. And anyway, fascinating history. And a couple years ago, the pastor that's serving my home congregation, if you will, reached out to me and said, "Bryan, are you going to be here for the 175th? So I want to be able to go for that event. So next week, Pastor Jeff Duncan, who's been here before, he's our newly elected circuit visitor. He's with Lutherans for Life and works part-time as assistant pastor at Mount Calvary. Anyway, he's going to be here this next weekend leading worship and Bible class. Also, to remind you, on the 21st of this month, the Dave Murphy Quintet will be here at 7 o'clock, and it's the last of our jazz series of concerts, and the Mobile Grace food truck will be here at 6, and so it promises to be a wonderful evening as well. Also, if we are in the process of launching a new member series of classes for people that maybe have been attending here for a while and maybe are thinking about taking the next step of joining the congregation, and those classes will begin on the 22nd of this month at 7 o'clock. I think that about covers the waterfront. I'll be in the back to greet you today. Have a wonderful week in the Lord. Thank you.